Up from the depths of the orchestra pit rose the biggest, goldest, most colorful pipe organ console anyone in the packed house had ever seen. A medley of the day's most popular tunes captivated and enthralled the audience. It was the Fox's Mighty Molar, then and now the second largest theater pipe organ in the world. 3,600 pipes, the largest 16 feet tall, the smallest the size of a stubby pencil. The unique Molar organ sported four keyboards, 376 stop tablets, and 26 special effects, from bells, sirens, and whistles to train engines and thunder, 7 miles of cable and wire, plus the instrument's electro-pneumatic devices and engine, filled 5 rooms above and below the stage. Today, over 50 years later, the wonderful Molar organ, and indeed the entire Fox Theater, are still in fine working order, thanks in large part to the skill, patience, dedication, and outright love of one man, Joe Patten. In 1963, Joe was working in Atlanta area hospitals as an X-ray engineer. He learned that the Fox's famous organ was in desperate need of restoration, and he decided to do something about it. Theater organist Bob Van Camp remembers.
Now, the major problem in restoring the organ had to do with the cable that runs from the organ down to the spreader board in the bottom of the pit. From going up and down numerous times, that cable had runs in it. So at the beginning of a show, when you brought the organ up, you played what you wanted to play, and the organ had a mind of its own. It hooted and popped and peeped notes all over the place as the cable came up. Obviously, the first thing to do is replace the cable. So Joe foresaw that this had to be done, chopped the original cable, installed new cable, and in the process ran the equivalent of 7 miles of individual wires. The theater management said 4 and 4 only people may be in this theater at any time to work on the organ. Joe was the chairman of the committee, I was on the committee, and there were 2 other members who, very frankly, at the time Joe chopped the cable, threw up their hands and said, "It'll never play again." And that was all Joe Patten needed to hear. He said, "It will play again." And that's how he came to spend 10 months of working night and day, 7 days a week, to be sure it worked again.
Joe Patten remembers those days, too.
On Friday evening, I would come in, or if I needed some assistance of some kind, we would come in about 10:30 or 11 o'clock. And the theater would close maybe 11:30 or 12 in the at midnight, and could work. We had the opportunity then to work all night long and into the morning. And then the theater would open back up about 12 noon. I'd go back home and go to sleep, and then come back in that evening. That project was completed, and the organ was reintroduced in November of that same year with Bob Van Camp playing a most memorable presentation at that time. The excitement there was not necessarily hearing the organ, but to hear what would happen when the organ was played with a large number of people, and to see and hear their response to it, and to hear the applause and the tremendous interest that these people had. It's really exciting to me to sit in the balcony after the tuning job is complete and all things work, and just sit back and hear a great artist play the instrument. When you get somebody to play it well, then that's my reward for whatever I might have done on the instrument.
It probably is the greatest theater organ remaining in a theater today. It has a sound unlike the sound of any other theater organ, even that great Wurlitzer at the Times Square Paramount, which I think the organ world regards as, well, they call it the Dowager Empress or something like that. That organ did not, to me, have the variety of tone colors that this organ has. The fact that Joe Patten keeps it in good condition makes it a joy to play. Oh, I love it. It's just as simple as that.
But that's not all Joe does. Having conquered the Mighty Molar, Joe turned his interest, talent, and considerable energy to the organ's home, the grand old Fox Theater. More about Joe and the Fox when Nice People returns.
Thank you.
theater was built for this organ, and the organ was built for this theater. So they perform very well together.
Since they were built for each other, perhaps it's not so surprising they perform so well together. What is surprising is that the Fox Theater wasn't originally designed to be a theater at all. It was supposed to be a new home for Atlanta's Shriners organization, 5,000 strong. In 1916, they commissioned the architects to out-Baghdad Baghdad, and by most accounts, the architects did. Unfortunately for the Shriners, within 10 years, they could no longer afford to build the architects' elaborate vision. So movie magnate and millionaire William Fox was called in as a partner. He must have been delighted with the planned building's huge 5,000-seat auditorium, seen here in a famous old Life magazine portrait. It was designed as an open Arabian courtyard, replete with a simulated sky that had moving clouds, twinkling stars, even a sunrise and sunset. Fox added the latest in theatrical equipment so that when the building finally opened in 1929, it could handle simple movies and complex touring Broadway stage shows as well. Unfortunately for Fox and for his fabulous new theater, the Great Depression had just begun. But the theater survived that, and the next 4.5 decades as well. What it almost didn't survive was the year 1974. Fortunately, Joe Patten was there.
Southern Bell was planning to buy the property to build a building, their southeastern headquarters. The building was to be torn down, not by Southern Bell, but by the owners, Mosk Incorporated, and Southern Bell was to be given a cleared piece of land.
Once again, Joe Patten decided to do something. He joined forces with other concerned Atlantans who together had a single goal, to save the Fox. They mobilized and organized hundreds of volunteers throughout the city and across the state and collected donations from literally thousands of people. In February of 1978, Joe's group paid off the mortgage on the theater and began restoring the elegant old building to its original luster. Atlanta attorney Bob Foreman was part of that group.
Joe was the catalyst that brought together the chemicals who saved the building. He was not only the catalyst, he was one of the chemicals that worked together to save the Fox for the future. I don't believe any one person could have saved the Fox alone, even Joe. But I think it may well have been impossible to save it without Joe. He is a nice person, but he's not a Pollyanna. He's not somebody who is only nice. Joe has a tremendous amount of character. He has many, many talents. He has strong feelings about the matters he believes in, and I suppose you would have to say that the strongest principle he has is that the Fox Theater would not be torn down, but would be preserved. He's a remarkable person, and Atlanta is quite lucky to have somebody like him looking after such things as the Fox Theater.
Today, the fabulous Fox Theater in Atlanta, home to the mighty Mohler organ, stands as one of only 3 movie palaces in the country designated National Historic Landmarks. It stands thanks to the skill, patience, dedication, and outright love of many, not the least of whom is one Joe Patten, who had some very special feelings when the old building was finally rescued from the wrecker's ball.
I really felt good because I knew at that point that the theater was going to remain forever.